Good morning, students. In the series of video lectures on Azadi, a very famous novel composed by Chaman Nahal, we are now coming to the part fourth. As I have told you, this is a novel, big novel. It has been divided by the author into three parts. The first part has been termed as Dallal, which consists of five chapters, and the second part, which has been termed as The Storm, it consists of six chapters, and the last part, that is the third part, is the Aftermath, which consists of one chapter. In this part, that is the fourth part of the summary, we are taking up Part 2, The Storm, chapters number 3 to 5, summary. As we have done up to chapter 2 of The Storm in earlier videos, so now we will concentrate on chapter 3 to chapter 5 of the second part of the novel, the Azadi. As I have told you, it is prescribed in BA part 2, paper 2, English literature. And myself is Dr. Vijayendra Singh Tamar, associate professor in English. Presently, I have been posted at Government College, Gurda. Now let us begin the summary of the chapter 3, part 2 of the novel, The Storm. As in the chapter 2 of The Storm, we came to know that Rahmatullah Khan was a friend of Arun, offered him a golden chance that if he could bring Sunanda for one evening, he could manage for Arun and his family members personally, and they will be safe in India and he will escort them in his jeep. But Arun did not compromise at that. So Arun lost the lofty chance to cross the border as he did not agree with Rahmatullah Khan in the matter of Sunanda. Now, this also hurt Arun and he wanted to have a quarrel with Captain in private and made him aware about his anger through reprobation. He wanted that he should try to humiliate Rahmat Ali Khan for his characterlessness. But nothing happened, did not get the chance. Neither Rahmatullah Khan gave him the chance. During this, when he was idle, he was thinking of Sunanda and Rahmat Ali Khan. He came into contact with Chandani. He was lying awake at the time of night on his cot. He suddenly saw Chandani. Her beautiful breasts were moving up and down because of her taking breath. He was impressed by her beauty, and all of a sudden he fell in love with Chandani. Now he started having some kind of physical contact with Chandani, but Chandani was afraid of it. She was afraid of Arun's erotic advancement, as there was a difference between the social status of the two. Chandani was just a servant and he belonged to a respectable and rich family. She gave her arguments when Arun declared her love for her, but Arun had different views. He told her, "We are living in different India. No one can talk of caste today, and we are so poor, all that has no relevance now because they have also lost all their property and they have also become poor. After the partition, we are in a different phase, means they are at a same level. Arun's was of a more modern outlook, so his young mind saw no impediment which could restrain him from marrying Chandni. He told his mother. His mother gave some, you can say, impediments that she is illiterate, her status, etc. Then he says, no, neither her education, her status, her breeding, her poverty, they do not matter to Arun. He is in love and he wants to marry her. His mother realized it. So, a romance between Arun and Chandni started. It became customary for the two of them to meet at the fence near the water taps at night in tent. Chandni was sleeping in the same tent in which Arun's family was sleeping. So Arun used to come near Chandni and they had to some kind of relationship. Though he was well aware of the fact that it will be a great humiliation for the family and for him if he is caught, but he was in love and no risk for its sake was too great for him. Chandni was impressed by his love. She flowered strangely under the impact of Arun's love. She believed Arun really wanted her and Arun will marry her. She started giving more importance to Arun's parents, doing their service. She now became extra concerned for his parents and tried to anticipate their demands. She used to say, "What, Chachiji?" she said eagerly when Prabharani raised her head to summon her. She started having dreams about their happy married life. She also started giving more importance to Arun's father, that is Nala Kasira. And one day Arun declared to his mother, "Ma, I want to marry Chandni." Prabharani was not impressed, but she did not say no. She said that this is not the right time to talk of marriage as they have suffered the death of his sister. And she also raised some objections regarding her education, poverty, caste. When Arun was adamant, she told him that Arun should talk to his father about this. After saying this, Arun went and brought Chandni and asked her to touch his mother's feet. His mother was surprised. She only said, "I don't know what Arun had been telling you. Please know, I have made no promises. Be good, both of you, and let time take its course." Means it will be the time which will be the deciding factor between their relationship. Though they were living in refugee camp, but the routine life of the people was same. They have adjusted in the refugee camp. People woke up around 6. They went to toilet in the community latrines, bathed in the community bathrooms, collected dry rations of wheat and rice from the government store, ate lunch come breakfast around 11, spent the afternoon visiting fellow refugees in the camp, had the night meal around 7 and went to sleep soon after. This was the routine of the refugees which were living in the Sialkot refugee camp. And their number was very high. It is estimated that about 20,000 people were living in that refugee camp. So it was a kind of village, you can say. and children were born every day, and many people died every day. And one such incident happened when Sardar Jodha Singh died after a brief illness. He was cremated. And during this time, many refugees left for India. Mangat Ram, Lala Bihari Lal, and others who managed somehow to either through railway or by personal means, but they left for India. It was not sure whether they have reached India safely or not. Lala Kasi Ram suggested Niranjan to leave by train on account of Isar Kaur, as Isar Kaur was pregnant. Her delivery may take place at any time. So he suggested to Niranjan that they should take the course of train. They agreed, but on the appointed day, the Isar Kaur's health was not well, so it was cancelled. Now they decided to go on foot with Lala Kasi Ram's family, and it was also the desire or wish of Isar Kaur to go in the company of Prabharani. One more thing, for safety purposes, Sikhs were required to cut their hair. Niranjan Singh was also asked that he should shave, but he refused. He did not agree to that. He said, his dharma says, lose your head if need be. Don't lose your Sikh faith. The idea is, he was a strong believer in his faith, religion. And according to his faith, he should not cut his hair. He said, Guru Maharaj couldn't protect. When he said all this about Guru Maharaj, then Lala Kasi Ram told him that Guru Maharaj couldn't protect his own birthplace. How will he protect you? Said Lala Kasi Ram. As there were reports from the Nankana Sahib, had it all the Sikhs were massacred there and the screen was closed. He also told Niranjan that these religions are meant to be practiced only where human life exists. You can't practice them when beastly times prevail. And even among humans, they must be accepted with a pinch of salt. Then Niranjan said, it is a matter of convenience if you change your religion according to demands. Then Lala Kasi Ram says, it is giving religion chance to work again through you and do good on earth. If you perish, your religion will perish with you. Suraj Prakash also tried to make Niranjan understand things, that he should cut his hair, but he gave his own arguments that if he will cut, he will be able to reach in India, and there he will able to enjoy sleeping with Muslim girls, which will be kept there for them. Anyway, he was not convinced. Niranjan Singh was not convinced by anyone. With the passage of time, the date of the foot convoy to Dehradun Baba Nanak was fixed and a massive preparation were organized. And also, escort troops arrived from India under the command of Rana Jang Bahadur Singh. They were to protect the refugees from any kind of attack on them. He told the refugees, you should not have fears. We will take you safely. About 20,000 people in the convoy. It meant a column over 10 miles in length. So it was very lengthy. March, it was very difficult task to provide safety to all. The convoy was a shorter and more direct route. to Amritsar. Means he decided that we should adopt a short route to reach Amritsar. We would not touch Wagha border. Along the route, there were two more refugee camps, one at Pesrur and the other at Narowal. They were both tehsils headquarters. So from there, the refugees will be included in the this convoy. Dera Baba Nanak, the border was 47 miles away from Sialkot. Lala Kasi Ram was also appointed the leader of one unit. He was able to arrange place for Isar Khan in a Isar Kaur in a truck and made a record of all the members with their age, their health, that these are old people, these are children, they should be given place in trucks, or they should walk on foot, etc., etc. He worked very hard. A number of people had carts with them, pulled by buffaloes or bullocks. Many had bicycles. The convoy was to leave on the 24th of September. Niranjan Singh was asked to cut his hair. He agreed this time, but he said he would do it a day before they were to set out. For the first time, Issar Kaur, who used to pressurize Niranjan Singh that he should cut his hair, slept peacefully that night. And she lost in dream. And in dream, she saw something. And she also thought about her child. She wanted the first child should be as a girl to her. She was sleeping, she was enjoying her sleep and dream. Suddenly she was informed that her husband had set fire on himself. And he had stated, "My life I may lose, my Sikh Dharma I won't." And this impressed by all the witnesses. The witnesses who were there, they all said Niranjan Singh was a martyr. He sacrificed his life in the cause of religion. Soon Niranjan Singh was reduced to a handful of bones and he was brought in a vessel and it was given to Issar Kaur. She kissed him and took him into the tent. This incident made an impression on all the refugees, particularly on Chandni. Chandni was greatly frightened and she fiercely clung to Arun. This was the first unnatural death she had seen and she was all shaken up. She asked Arun to make her his wife. She was so much terrified that she wanted to marry him as early as possible. But he promised her that after reaching India, they will marry. Now, on the appointed day, Chaudhary Barkat Ali, Munir, and other Muslim friends of refugees, they came to see them off. When they came, Munir handed a letter to Arun, which was written by Noor. The letter had some emotional message. And after some time reading the letter, in the letter, Noor declared her love for Arun. Both were separated by political condition. From this letter, it was also clear that Noor saw no hope of meeting Arun again. As the convoy moved out in batches, crowd jeered at the men and women and shouted insults also. Lala Kasi Ram's unit was the fourth in the order of the march. There were 10 units of the 20,000 people. Lala Kasi Ram's was on the fourth position. Lala Kasi Ram saw Gangu Mal in the crowd. Gangumal, you know, was the husband of Bibi Amarvati. Gangumal told that he is now Ghulam Muhammad and he has converted and he has decided to live in Sialkot and he is now thinking of marrying a Muslim girl also. when this news came to or reached Bibi Amarvati, she said he married her because of her property, not because of love to her. Gangumal disappeared suddenly, and when Bibi Amarvati inquired about Mukunda's mother, he was given information, that is, Lalaji was given information, which he passed to Bibi Amarvati, that one day rioters attacked the building and they killed. And also Mukunda, who was in prison, there was communal riots and many Hindu prisoners were killed, and Mukunda was also one of them. Now Munir and Barkat Ali accompanied them for 6 miles for the first half. Then Chaudhry Barkat Ali said, if not in our lifetime, inshallah, in the lifetime of our children, this folly will surely be undone. Arun also remembered Noor, the memory of the first love is always a little more tender than that of the other persons. It is very difficult to forget it. Arun also made inquiries about Bill Davidson. Munir told him he had been transferred back home and had already left for England. Now, in the first halting camp, Arun walked in the open fields. He enjoyed the fields and he wished Chandani's company in Gunakala camp, which is the place where they were stayed for the first halt. So after that, all left and the camp restarted, and they reached at Pasru, the tehsil headquarter. They were obliged to spend 4 days there. Why? Because the arrangements for the departure of refugees from the local camp had not yet been completed. There were only 2,000 refugees in the camp, and it was decided to distribute them amongst 10 units of the convoy. No extra unit was found for them. Keeping the safety and other things in view, this was decided. Now, no attack came, and the convoy set out on the fifth day after its arrival in Pasru. Though after walking so many miles, all were very tired. It was a weary convoy which pulled out of Pasrur. Manners were taught from 4 sleepless nights. In each village they passed, they found the remains of parties that had been attacked and butchered. In many cases, the dismembered human limbs, skeletons, were still lying there, and the stench of intolerable. So there was a bad smell of, you can say, human bodies lying without being given the due cremation. Hindus and Sikhs' places of worship were defiled, and obscene words were written over their religious places. Jang Bahadur tried to make inquiry about any Hindu in the village, but no Hindu was found in villages. Either they have been killed or converted. The first attack on the convoy came soon afterwards. There was firing ahead of their unit. Now see, the first unit which was marching in the front was attacked by the rioters. The convoy was halted for over 2 hours. People looked wan with fear and tension. But anyhow, they reached Kila Sobha Singh, and there they came to know about the attack, what was in the attack. Lala Kasiram saw the body of Dr. Chandra Bhan during the passage. He was killed mercilessly by Muslims. Mrs. Chandra Bhan and 3 children were survived the attack. 2 of their daughters aged 19 and 17 were abducted, were kidnapped by the rioters. Still over 200 Hindus and Sikhs were killed in this attack. Many women were abducted and many injured. The second attack took place near a notorious Muslim stronghold village called Alipur Saidiyan. It was at 10 in the morning on the ninth day and the 36 miles away from Sialkot that the advanced section of the convoy entered the premises of the camp at Narowal. And it was attacked. They had lost over 1500 of their number. Now in this attack, about 1500 people died. No one saved, none had a path since they left Pasrur. Major Jang Bahadur ordered a halt of a week for the convoy to recoup and recover its strength. But now it was the right time to take appropriate rest and then go to India, because from there India was a few miles away. Now in chapter 5th, which is very important, Narowal was a town in sizable population with a heavy concentration of Muslim zamindars. Narowal tehsil headquarter, and there was one refugee camp also. So Dera Baba Nanak border was only 8 miles from Narowal. So there ran one of the 5 rivers of the Punjab, the river Ravi. Now, so they were to stay for 1 week in Narowal. They reached Narowal after surviving 2 attacks. Now Suraj Prakash took aside Arun and told him, "You know, they are going to parade naked women in the town this afternoon. Wouldn't you like to go and see?" Arun and other refugees, they came to know about this information. They were very terrified, afraid. And the author or the novelist describes about the parade. He says, "The whole camp heard about the parade. A number of abducted Hindu and Sikh women were in their custody. Many of the kidnapped women disappeared into private homes. A lone Muslim dragged a woman away and kept her for his own explosive use, or he took her with the consent of other Muslims, converted her to Islam and got married to her." This is okay that one person who is not getting married, who nobody loves him, he took one girl and gets married, it's okay. But the rest of the girls were subjected to mass rape at times in public places and in the presence of large gathering. The rape was followed by atrocities, chopping off the breast and even death. Many of pregnant women had their wombs torn open. This novel is described as an undescribable atrocities on women. We will not be wrong. The survivors, means the girls, after passing all these atrocities, if they survived, the survivor detained for repeated rapes and humiliation until they were parceled out to decrepit wrecks. Decrepit means the aged person, the leftovers who couldn't find a wife, or those Muslim who wanted an additional wife. In the meantime, more women were abducted and the cycle was repeated all over again. It was some of these women recently brought to Narowal that Muslim of the town decided to parade through the streets. The local authorities, the police, the military did not interfere when such gatherings were organized. The only restrictions they placed this time was that the procession should not be taken to the refugee camp. They did not want an outright clash. Both Arun and Suraj Prakash, they disguised themselves as Muslims and decided to see the parade and they went into the village. Now they saw, what they saw is very horrible. The procession arrived, Arun counted them. There were 40 women marching two abreast. Their ages varied from 16 to 30, although to add to the grotesqueness of the display, there were two women marching right at the end of the column who must have been over 60. They were all stark naked. Their heads were completely shaven. So were their armpits. So were their pubic regions. Shorn of their body hair and clothes, they looked like baby girls or like the bald embryos one sees preserved in methylated spirit. Only the breast and the hips gave away the age. Means we came to know about their ages by only their hips and breast. The women walked awkwardly, looking only at the ground. They were all crying, though their eyes had no tears. They have suffered so much that there were no tears left in their eyes to express their pain. At the head of the procession marched a single drummer with a flat drum, thumping heavily on it, announcing their arrival. And the people who were gathered there were looking at this parade. They gave foul abuses, crude personal gestures, spurts of sputum, odd articles like small coins, faded flowers, cigarette butts, BDs that were thrown at the women. Crowd lifted their dungis to display their genitals to them, stared at the pubic regions of the women. And they were shouting, rape them, put it inside of them, the filthy Hindu witches, the kafir women. Some said worse things. Means they were not treated as it human beings, but worse than that things. The Hakim Sahib, who had a shop and he also saw this, he was deeply touched by this scene and he expressed his feeling. He covered his face with his hands and was rocking a little, and he was saying, Allah, Allah, Allah. And then he knelt on his knees, raised his arms, spread his hands before him as while saying namaz. There was a look of infinite pain on his face. He murmured in Punjabi, Rabba Almeen, forgive these cruel men. And oh my Allah, oh Rabbah, protect these women. Hakim Sahib had seen the very core of evil and he wanted to see nothing else. He wanted to despise the race that could be so barbaric. But the bearded Muslim weeping for Hindu women made no sense to them. Some of the men had identified one of Dr. Chandrabhan's daughters amongst the marchers, as we learned that two of his daughters were abducted. So the girl who were part of the parade, one of them was identified as Chandrabhan's daughters. About other, nobody knew nothing about her. Women were shocked. Chandni was disturbed by this news. She met Arun, said, make me you usefully. She was so perturbed that she lost her balance of mind and she wanted to marry as early as possible. And she requested Arun to take her fully. On the third night of their stay at Noroval, there was a massive attack on the camp and it was not expected. It was a complete surprise because it was a well-protected place, but they were attacked. A large number of Muslims from nearby villages came to attack, shouting slogans, Narae Takbir, Allahu Akbar, etc., etc. They were shouting. It appeared this was done with the help of authorities of Pakistan because there was a perfect coordination between the assailants and those who were giving them the cover. It was quite clear that they have been given the help of in Pakistani army. At that time when this attack happened, Arun was not in the camp. He thought of his parents and Chandni and ran here and there in the field to save himself. He ran here sometimes in the fields, sometimes there. And when he was running to save his life in the field, suddenly he heard the cry of Suninda from a bar. He saw an army jeep there. He reached the bar with great difficulty. He opened the gate, which was locked from inside with great difficulty. And there he saw that Rahmatullah Khan was trying to rape Suninda. He killed Rahmatullah Khan. And when they were out, Suninda told him everything. After some taking precautions, both of them reached the camp and met the other member of the family. But at the camp, there was no news of Chandni and Suraj Prakash. Both of them were not available in the camp. After some time, body of Suraj Prakash was found the later of the day. Padmani was asked about Chandni. Then she told, three men caught hold of Chandni and dragged her away. Arun thought, why did they leave Padmani? She is not so bad to look at herself. But it was told she offered herself to them if they could spare her daughter, but they hit her with a stick and left her unconscious. She also thinks she was dishonored while she lay unconscious. Arun was not feeling happy. He was feeling very ill, sick, and he hated both his father and Padmani. Why? Because both of them were against the union of Chandni and Arun. Then authorities of Pakistan, just to try to show that they are very liberal, they said that they have arrested many persons. They have tried to search the missing persons. Some women were found, but not Chandni. They were taken away by the family members, but Chandni was not found. There was one more village, last village, which was thickly populated before reaching India, and it was a Muslim village named Jassar. They were expecting attack from this village, but that village, the people of the village did not attack. On the contrary, they gave them all kinds of help, water, milk, to the refugees. And all the people slowly and slowly crossed the border and reached India, Dera Baba Nanak. Though Arun reached, but he was not happy. He started moving a twig, whirling it without looking at people. His behavior was abnormal. Then one of the elderly refugees said, the boy has lost his mind and he was behaving in such a manner. In this way, the chapter comes to a close, and we will now reach the chapter 6 in the next part of the video. Or next video, you will get the final summary of the novel. Thank you very much.